नेचर ऑफ रूरल अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट इन इंडिया.
ओके
एग्जैक्टली सर.
So let's begin the class. Can you hear me?
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Yes,
Yes,
sir.
sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now it is established fact that there is widespread unemployment in the economy, in the country. Now, if there is such a massive unemployment in the country, especially in the rural areas, the government will not sit quietly. It has started certain programs to provide employment to the unemployed. Now, our rural area is not a very well developed. Most of the employment or most of the people are employed or occupied in agriculture and allied activities. And as we have seen that in rural areas, seasonal unemployment is prevalent. Landless laborers are there. With the ongoing of mechanization of agriculture, laborers have been displaced, and there was not much alternative employment opportunities for these rural areas people. So, in the decade of 70s, international institutions, World Bank, our own Indian economists, they came out with findings that unemployment has increased. Poverty is closely correlated. If anyone is unemployed, then we can take it that he is poor. And otherwise, vice versa, poor people are mostly unemployed because they do not have their own assets to work with. They do not have their own capital to do something. So now so many programs have been started that we cannot study each and every individual program easy. So all the measures which were taken by the government are studied in a scientific and system. Can say that there are two categories of employment provision by the government. I will just show you a slide and then I will start from there. Can you see it? You see, it is programs for providing employment in rural areas. We have divided it into two major portions. Number one is known as wage employment programs, and number two is known as self-employment programs or income generating programs. Now, in this way, we can easily understand and study this employment programs started by the government from time to time. Now, in the last class, I have told you that in this unit 2 on agriculture sector, you may get a question from rural employment or providing employment in rural areas. It is not necessary or compulsory that you will get a question on this. You are going to get a question on sources of rural credit, various sources of rural credit in rural areas. That I am sure that you will get that question, but there is one, and you have to attempt one. Even if the questions is not asked in the examination, then too, it is very necessary and essential to know what potentials are there, what kind of employment has been provided, and in the light of that, in future also, we can continue with such programs with modifications, with changes from time to time. So let us see, concentrate on the first one, wage employment program. Wage employment program, at the end of the day, you are given your on daily basis, wages can be paid on weekly basis, wages can be paid on monthly basis also. Wages can be paid in rupees, in cash. It can be paid in kind, that is, you may be provided food grains instead of wages. There are so many reasons for that. You can think of that. So, for the first time in 1973-74, a program was started, that is wage employment program, known as Food for Work program. If I have discussed it, let me know. If I have not discussed it, then I'll discuss it for a few minutes. Have I talked about this Food for Work program? Anyone?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir. You only.
No, sir.
Okay, okay. You see, Food for Work program was started in the forest area. India has a large area covered in the forest, and there are people who are living in the forest. They are mostly dependent on, for their livelihood, on forest produce. No agriculture can be done in forest area because felling of trees or cutting of trees is a crime in the country, unless and until you get permission. The only person, the only people who have got the license to cut trees are the government. And governments are fools. They are fool, they are blind. They have cut down all the trees in the urban areas, which is impacting the environment. Anyway, that is not the point here. Food for Work program means you work for the day, you plant trees, plantation is done or you clear the forest, things like that. And at the end of the day, you are not given wages, but you are provided food grains. You may be provided rice, you may be provided wheat, you may be provided dal. Why this food for work program was started, the logic behind it, that most of the people who are unemployed are poor people. Poor people take loans, take money from money lenders or influential people around them. If you give them cash, then they may be forced to hand over the money to the lender. So their family may not get enough food grains to eat. So that is the reason why food grains are provided. The second reason is that poor people are in a bad habit of consuming liquor, gambling and other things. So they are provided food grains so that their family can survive on that. They can quench their hunger because with food grains. So, but this was a very small program and this was started in a very limited area. Because we had got certain aid or help, financial help from world bodies to enrich our forest, to stop the degradation of our forest. So it was not an all India level program. Then other program, that is, I have written SFDA. SFDA means Small Farmers Development Agency. If small farmers, we know, are people who own a small size of land. They are unemployed for a major portion of the year. So government provided them employment. Some project, some work was started in the village area. Refurnished, things like that, or plantation was undertaken, or for that they were given employment, manual employment for the day, and they got wages in return. Then there were other programs which were targeted program, that is marginal farmers and agricultural laborers. Similar kind of program was started for marginal farmers and agricultural labor. But a big program at the national level was started in 1981 and it was known as National Rural Employment Program, NREP. National Rural Employment Program, NREP. Money was allotted to the panchayats, to the development of the villages, and in the off season, in the lean season, when there was seasonal unemployment, some work was undertaken. For example, a school was constructed. For example, again, bylanes were constructed. The nalas of the villages were maintained. Plantation was started. There were many works, which were started in the National Rural Employment Program. And people were provided employment for at least 100 days in a year. 100 means at more than 3 months in a year. And the program was implemented by the administration, that is block. Every, in the rural areas, the administrate around 100 villages come under one block. So in villages, with the help of the cooperation of the panchayat, such program was started, that is National Rural Employment Program. So at least there was some sort of employment for few days, 100 days is not less, for the villagers. Then in 1983, another program of similar nature was started, which was known as Rural Landless Employment Guarantee Program, RLEGP. It was started in 1983. Now, NREP and RLEGP were similar kind of programs. The only difference was that in NREP, the program was financed by the central government. In Rural Landless Employment Guarantee Program, 50% of the program was financed by the central government and 50% of the program was financed by the state government. So there was some confusion. When somebody wanted work, work was not started because the panchayat or the block officials used to say that this is the program of central government, they should start. And the central government said that it is the duty and it comes under the state government, it should start. So there was certain confusion. So what happened in 1989? These NREP and RLEGP program was merged into one and it was renamed Jawahar Rozgar Yojana. So from 1989, providing wage employment to the unemployed was known as Jawahar Rozgar Yojana. So you can find many works were done in 1989. Most of you were not born, so you are not aware. But some kind of work was going on, not on regular basis, on a massive scale, but money was spent and some money was given to the poor people, to the unemployed people, so they could survive, sustain. There was not much resentment because there was an avenue, there was an opportunity of employment, even if it was for 100 days or 50 days or 60 days, it was a gift for the poor people of the villages. Unemployed people, they thought that something is better than nothing. Now in India, what happens? Many times, several times, we find that the same programs are run with different names. When the government changes, when there is a change of power in the center, then most of the programs are rechristened, renamed. Nothing much changes. For example, you have taken admission in University of Allahabad. Very soon, there are pressure on the university that you change the name of the university as Prayagraj Vishwavidyalaya or University of Prayagraj. Now, some of you may think it is a very good idea, some of you may not agree, but the university people are not agreeing to it easily. But you cannot resist much because the government is very powerful. They can do whatever they want. So if you change the name of Allahabad University to Prayagraj University or to Pratapgarh University or to Bahrait University, nothing will change. Things will go in the same way it is going on. But University of Allahabad carries a name. It is an old university, more than 125 years old university. If you go to anywhere, not in the country but around the world, and if you tell someone that you are from University of Allahabad, that is, at least they will acknowledge you. They have heard the name. But the moment you get a certificate or a degree of University of Prayagraj, then even in your own country, many people will ask you, where is this University of Prayagraj? When more is established? So changing name is a very common thing in the country. So Jawahar Rozgar Yojana name was changed to स्वरोजगार जवाहर
सर व्हाट इज द बेनिफिट ऑफ चेंज इन द नेम
द बेनिफिट ऑफ चेंजिंग द नेम इज फॉर पीपल लाइक अस मोस्ट ऑफ अस आर फूल्स वी थिंक इफ यू चेंज द नेम ऑन सर्टेन फॉर सर्टेन रीजन ऑन रिलीजियस ग्राउंड एंड थिंग देन डेवलपमेंट विल टेक प्लेस ऑन इट्स ओन People will be very happy. So it has no logical reasons, because most of us, many of our politicians think they make you think. They don't think they make you think that India was a very developed country at one time. We had rockets, we had aeroplanes, we had fighter jets. But with time, all has vanished, and we were captured by foreigners. They ruled over us and they destroyed us. We don't have any documented history that India was a very advanced country with all the modern science which we have today present in ancient time. So changing name is just to get vote and nothing else. So Swarojgar नॉट स्वरोजगार शास्त्री जवाहर जवाहर समृद्धि रोजगार योजना जवाहर समृद्धि रोजगार योजना PSRY वॉज स्टार्टेड इन 1997 जवाहर रोजगार योजना वॉज रीनेम्ड एज जवाहर समृद्धि रोजगार योजना इन 1997 Now, if a program is running that is Jawahar Rozgar Yojana, if the same program is renamed, then the public thinks that the government has started a new program. When the fact is that no new program is started, it is the old program in a new bottle. The name has only changed. This Jawahar Samriddhi Rozgar Yojana was again renamed as Prime Minister Rozgar Yojana, PMRY, Prime Minister Rozgar Yojana. Then it was renamed as Jawahar Grameen Samriddhi Yojana. The program was same. But in February 2005, it came into effect in February 2006. The new program was launched. The old, that is NREP, RLAGP, Jawahar Rozgar Yojana or Prime Minister Rozgar Yojana, it was started with a new name that is known as NREGA. In February 2006. Now, what is the difference between Jawahar Rozgar Yojana or NREP, RLAGP or Prime Minister Rozgar Yojana or Jawahar Grameen Samriddhi Yojana and NREGA? What is the difference? There is a big major difference. In 2005, there was a demand from public that this Rozgar Yojana employment program should be given a legal status. It should be turned into a law. And it was accepted and it was done. So it is National Agriculture Rural Employment Guarantee, National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. NREGA is National, NA is National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. If you want a work, if someone in the village who is unemployed, he writes down a application to the Gram Pradhan or to the secretary Sachiv of the Panchayat that he needs work, then within 15 days, the work has to be provided. If the Panchayat fails to provide work in 15 days, then that person is eligible to get money, that is employment stipend, unemployment stipends, berozgari bhatta you call it, for not providing employment. This employment, unemployment stipend is less than the real wages. For example, if the wage which are paid in this program is say 200 rupees, then he will be provided 60 rupees, 100 rupees, 80 rupees for not providing employment by the panchayat. So NREGA, this law has been passed in the parliament. Before NREGA, NREGA is an act. Act is passed by the parliament, Sansad of the country. It has become a law. Prior to NREGA, all the employment programs were only programs. If the government wanted, they can start it. If the government does not want, you cannot force the government to start the program. So NREGA was the act, and if the government fails to provide employment, then they are forced to pay unemployment allowances or stipend, whatever you may call it. Again, this NREGA name was changed. As I said, that names are changed frequently, but nothing has changed, only the name has changed. Now it has been renamed after Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Guarantee Act in October 2009, name was changed. And till this date, NREGA is running successfully in the country. It is said, studies have confirmed that because of lockdown, because of massive migrant workers coming back to their home during the lockdown period after corona, it was NREGA which sustained the economy. If there was no NREGA, then there would have been too much violence in the country because of unemployment. But NREGA is successful running in the country. And there are certain criticism of NREGA, that is, wages are not paid in time, work is not given, things like that. But the plus point of NREGA or the plus point of wage employment program is very crucial and important, and one has to understand it. For example, in NREGA or in NREGA, now it is NREGA, so I will talk only of NREGA. There are more than 100 and 200 types of work which can be undertaken under NREGA. This is the biggest program, being an unemployment program, run in the world, you can say. Now, the kind of works which are undertaken under NREGA are to develop the infrastructure of the rural areas. In order to increase the productivity or production capacity of the rural area. Today you will find that every village in the country, even in Uttar Pradesh, they have got connecting roads. In the villages, they have got water pipe. There is effort to clean. Every village has got a school. Building has been built. There are ponds have been dug. Old ponds which has dried down has been refurnished or refurbished. Even in NREGA or NREGA, if you own a land, if there is a small farmer or a marginal farmer and his land is barren, his land is not productive, work can be undertaken on that land in order to make it productive. So you think of any kind of work and you will find that it comes under NREGA, and the finance or money is given by the government, and there is a structure, and the panchayat is asked to undertake that work. the villagers get employment, the unemployed get employment also, and at the same time the infrastructure, the productive capacity of the village is increased. If ponds are built on big scale, then the water level will come up, agriculture productivity will grow up. If you happen to, you cannot see such kind of work on the field in Uttar Pradesh, because Uttar Pradesh is a very different kind of a state. Here the dynamic, the social categories which are inhabiting in a village are very diverse. Most of the time, for example, right now, you know that on 15th of April, panchayat election will take place. Now, panchayat election has become so important that it has become as important as the election of parliament. For panchayat election, people are killed, murder takes place, all sorts of tricks are undertaken. Why? Because every five years, if you become the head of the panchayat, if you become a representative of the panchayat, then development finance is provided. That is, you may get 1 crore, 2 crore rupees to develop your village and its surrounding, and then there is a scope of making money out of it through unlawful means. But if you give a serious thought, MGNREGA is such a program that if it is implemented properly, then development of rural areas can take place. If you go to Chhattisgarh, if you go to some place in Jharkhand, even in Madhya Pradesh, the Chhattisgarh, you can see then thousands and thousands of ponds which had dried are now full of water. They have been cemented, they have built with concrete also. In all villages you will find bylines, you will find, even in some villages you will find that drinking water is supplied through tankers. Hand pumps are, in hand pumps motor are installed and water is supplied to pipe to the villages, and things like this happens. Schools have been rebuilt. So development has taken place. If you visit the village, you can find it. For example, I happened to visit a village in some project in a place close around 40 kilometers from Bhopal in Madhya Pradesh. And believe me, that village was as developed a village as any village you can imagine of developed village. Everything was at its place because community participation was there. Everybody was interested. They made the MGNREGA work very productive and useful to the villagers. Whatever the problem they had, they asked the panchayat to work for some project for that, and employment was provided. At the same time, productive capacity of the area increased. So this wage employment program like MGNREGA is a very useful program in India, where unemployment is widely prevalent in the rural areas, and almost for 6 months majority of the population do not have any engagement or do not have any employment. So they can get employment, and at the same time the rural areas productive capacity can be increased and enhanced. Now you can ask a question, why this is not happening, why you cannot see, why there is so much distance in rural area. So the reason behind it, that all the money which is allocated for the development of the villages or for the development of the state or for the development of the country are not being utilized properly. There is massive corruption. Most of the work are done on paper only, but money is distributed among officials, among politicians. So people like you who will get educated, and if you go back, you can monitor, you can see if you know that. Unless and until the community, the population, they take effort. If we take effort, we can make the politicians work, we can make the administrative officers work. But for that, we have to get educated. The kind of education you are getting is not the proper education one must get. Because we still do not believe that all the government, whether it is the Prime Minister, whether it is the Chief Minister or all the ministers, they are our servants. We have elected them to work for us. But it appears that we are at their mercy. They make us work. They make us sit idle. They enjoy all the perks. They enjoy their life on our money, on our taxes. Even the administrative officers, the IAS, the district magistrate, the commissioner, the SDMs, the police, whether it is the SI, the IPS officers, the deputy SPs, they all are our servants. But we are not educated in that, and our frame of mind, because we have been gulam, we have been enslaved, we have been servants, we have been for such a long time of foreigners, of various kings, rajas, of Britishers, that our mindset is that we are here to be ruled. When in a democracy, it is the people who rule. It is the government of the people, for the people, by the people. But this definition of democracy is not applicable in our country. We think that if the government does anything, if the government comes out with a program, they are doing some favor to us. No. They are supposed to do that. We have to ask them what they are doing. For example, see the present situation. 1 year has passed since 2019, late 2019, it was detected that the world is suffering from a disease pandemic which is known as Corona. From March 2020, there was a lockdown. It was said that the government will prepare to fight with the disease. 1 year has passed. Today again, the second wave or the third wave, whatever you may call, has started in your country on a massive scale. And you can believe, for example, if somebody is serious and affected with corona, then today, at this moment I'm talking, there is no place in any hospital that you can get treatment. Because there are two or three hospitals and it is all fully occupied. People are patients are lying on the floor. They don't have any place. Medicines are in shortage. People are hoarding it. They are selling it in high rates. Black marketing is going on, life-saving drugs. There is shortage of cylinders. There is shortage of ventilators. We have wasted money on other purposes. In the name of this corona, people are fighting elections, they are distributing money to the voters, but they have not built up the infrastructure as required. And if such a situation of corona continues for another 1 month, believe me, the economy will again be in a distress. It will be destroyed and it will take years to rebuild the economy because we are not prepared to fight with corona. If you know someone in Maharashtra, if you know someone in Bombay, you will find what kind of situation they are going on. So anyway, that is not the point. The point is that MNREGA is a very, very effective, very, very good program. The only thing is that if it is implemented sincerely and seriously and honestly with a little application of mind, then the face of the rural areas, the agriculture sector can change because of this wage employment program. And this is a program which is very closely related with economic theory. if you remember, or you will study when you go in BA part 2, or if somebody knows a little bit economic, in 1930s, late 20s and 30s, when there was a widespread world depression in the world, then John Maynard Keynes came out with a theory which is known as general theory of income and employment. And here John Maynard Keynes said that in order to revive the economy, such wage employment programs should be started. If there is no work to be done, hire 1,000 laborers, ask them to dig a hole, ditch or pitch, and in the evening, then cover up the dig hole. And they have not done any work really, but they will be paid money, wage, so that demand can be generated. So this is such a good program. There are certain criticisms. I said that there are criticisms you can see in the textbook. Then let us go to the second program. The second category of program is self-employment program. The other name of self-employment program is income generating programs. Now, after you have, you must be give more attention on this self-employment programs, because it is closely connected with you. When you pass out with your degree, graduation or post-graduation degree, 99% of you will have to go for self-employment, because no employment will be provided private sector for people. In the daily wage,
yes, sir, what is the daily wage provided to MGNREGA workers, and is it sufficient for them?
Sometime in some state it is more than 200 rupees, 203 or so, but the central government, even this year in the her budget speech, the finance minister said that she has increased the wages by 7 rupees per day. So daily wages in MGNREGA is not around 250 or below 300. It happened that few years back, 5-6 years back, the daily wages in MGNREGA was higher than the wages which was paid in the villages to the laborers. So much so that there was shortage of laborers for agricultural work, because most of them used to prefer work for MGNREGA. But for that reason, now the daily wages are lower than the wages which is prevalent in the labor market, whether in village or whether it urban area. So daily wages keep on changing, and it varies from state to state. But it is that much which the government thinks that a person will be able to provide livelihood, food grains to his entire family, and the size of the family is assumed to be around 5. So if you do not get any money, if you are unemployed, but if you get even 200 rupees or 207 rupees or 6 rupees, then at least you can eat for the day. Anything else?
Sir, who finances MGNREGA?
The central government finances MGNREGA. The total amount which used to be financed under MGNREGA was much higher. But when this government, NDA government, came into 2014, then they said that MGNREGA is a useless program, we will throw it out. Here no work is done, no employment is provided. But within 2 years after coming into power, the economy started deteriorating, it started slow down, there was widespread unemployment, there was resentment, there was agitations. Then the government realized that MNREGA is a good program. Now the government says that MNREGA is a very good program. They may rename it after some time after, but the total money which is provided by under MNREGA has declined because the tax collection of the government has declined. So it is around 40,000 crores rupees are provided to the country under MNREGA. The finance minister has promised that she will increase the allocation when required, when needed.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Sir, what is the difference between NREP and EAS? The National Rural Employment Program
I know. What are you saying? I know. National Rural Employment Program was for the whole country. Employment Assurance Scheme, EAS, was started by the Maharashtra government in Maharashtra only. It was a similar kind of program as NREP. So if some state government wants to start its own program, they can. It was not essential, or it was not required that they have to seek permission of the central government. The state government has the right. So in Maharashtra, especially in Marathwada or Vidarbha area, there was drought for years. So the Maharashtra government started programs in the 80s of employment assurance scheme for their own people. So there is not much difference in the nature of the program. The kind of work is same. They are provided daily work and wages are given.
Sir, if a state starts a program, then can it be financed by the center and the state, and the cost share may be more by the center and less by the state?
No, it depends. You see, since many things have changed, now the indirect tax is collected mostly by the central government, not through GST. You must have heard about GST. Previously, it used to be sale tax. There were other taxes, sale tax and other taxes, which were collected by the state government. Now the tax is collected by the central government, and the central government returns the collected tax to the various states on basis of certain formula, on the basis of the population, on the basis of the economy's strength and all. But in the last 1 year, 1.5 year, the central government says that it has no revenues, it has not collected, the revenue has declined, and the central government is not paying the state government their dues, which are to be paid. So most of the state government has to take loan from various institutions in order to carry its routine work. So you are asking that any program which is started by a state government, can it be financed by the central government? No, it cannot be. If the central government wants, for example, if the chief minister of Uttar Pradesh starts a program, good program, I think somebody will advise him, he can start a good program also. Then because the chief minister comes from the same party which rules the center, then the center can. Then the center can provide finance. It is not hard and fast that they cannot, but mostly they do not provide finance to the state programs.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Sir, if you doesn't belong to the same party, then?
I said, even if you belong to the state and the central government belong to the same party, it is not necessary and essential that they will provide finance. Because if you provide a finance to Uttar Pradesh for a program, similar programs may be started by Rajasthan, and they will say, because you have given it to Uttar Pradesh, then give it to us. The center cannot discriminate between states. Can you understand?
Yes, sir.
So, in normal course of action, they will not finance any program which is started by the state government. Unless and until the state government has taken prior permission and the program is very good for the center also, then it can be done. Or the center may ask other institutions, for example, they can ask NABARD, they can ask Reserve Bank of India, they can ask other bodies to provide finance to the state government.
Okay, sir.
And Uttar Pradesh, it can be started because the next prime minister will be Yogi. So he is a very influential person. So nobody can say no to him.
So is it necessary that he will become next CM again?
No, I am not saying that it is necessary. It is coming in the newspaper that Yogi is trying to become the prime minister of the country in 2024. If he succeeds, then he will become, because his party is going to rule for another 50 years. So his turn may also come.
Okay, sir.
Sir, Bhai B, don't get rid of Naxal after 17 years of independence. Sir, it is the main reason of the areas of Chhattisgarh, they cannot be developed.
This is a political question, which I don't think I must answer. Though I have been to Chhattisgarh area, most of the Naxal affected area, where their headquarters are, I have been there, I have met them in a project. So it is a political question, it is a economic, for economic reasons they have developed. But if you ask me, it is the political parties which are financing them, which wants them, want the Naxalism never to end. Any movement which is going on in the country, for example in Northeast or in Kashmir or any other place, the problem does not end because the political parties, they don't want it to end. They use it in the election as a tool. That is the reason why election is taking place in Bengal, West Bengal right now, and you hear the speeches which is delivered by the politician. They are talking about Pakistan, they are talking about China, they are talking about Kashmir. What Bengal has to do with Pakistan, China and Kashmir? But so these are our electoral politics. Anything could be done. So Naxalites are alive because they have very good relations with the politicians of different political parties, and Naxals and Naxalites are very close to the IAS officers, administrative officers of Chhattisgarh government. They are very, very close. They have very good relationship with them. But right now, a person like you cannot read that much, or you have to go to the field area. If you visit the Jagdalpur area, if you visit the Narayanpur Tehsil, Abujmal Forest, you will know that the politicians, the administrative officers and these Naxal groups and other groups with indulgent violence, they are very close to each other. So they help each other. But nothing can be said with certainty why the Naxal movement, why development has not taken place there, what kind of development should take place there. But I can see that I have seen forest of Chhattisgarh, especially Bastar, that is known as Abujmal Forest. And I cannot describe, it is such a dense forest that even in the month of May, it was cold there. And people are not allowed to visit that forest because it is inhabited by Naxalites. So if one wants to go there, you have to take the permission from the district magistrate. Anyway, that is a political question you are asking, not related with.
Sir, is it Narayanpur Tehsil or Chunar Tehsil?
What?
सर ये नारायणपुर तहसील और चुनार तहसील?
नारायणपुर तहसील।
सर व्हाई मनरेगा इज नॉट डूइंग वेल इन यूपी, व्हाट इज द रीजन?
व्हाट
सर व्हाई मनरेगा इज नॉट डूइंग वेल इन यूपी, व्हाट इज द रीजन फॉर दिस?
यू आर द रीजन, आई एम द रीजन, वी ऑल आर द रीजन। वी कीप ऑन फाइटिंग अमंग ourselves on caste lines. There are Thakurs, there are Brahmins, there are Yadus, there are Kurmis. We all fight among themselves, then we join hands against the scheduled caste. We want to keep our dominance. So everybody, most of us in UP are corrupt people. They get money, they eat up, and nobody can question them because they are very strong persons. So we are ruled by mafias indirectly. But in the difference between Uttar Pradesh, some parts of Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh is that in Chhattisgarh, for example, Chhattisgarh, if you go to a village, most of the villagers are homogeneous group. They are of the same class, same caste. They are poor people. Most of them are tribe, they are simple people, they are honest people. It is easy to work with them. Even the government officials find it easy to work there. And most of the NGOs, non-governmental organizations, they are based in Chhattisgarh, in Madhya Pradesh, they help. There are NGOs in Uttar Pradesh also, for example, in Allahabad, in Prayagraj. Somebody asked me to write a report on the NGOs of Allahabad. I said, I know only 5 or 6 NGOs in Allahabad. Then that government official provided me a list. There are more than 2,000 NGOs in Allahabad or Prayagraj itself. I have never heard about it. And they have taken money from the government for development work. But they do not exist. They exist on paper. So such corrupt people, such people are here in Uttar Pradesh. It is said that the social dynamics in Uttar Pradesh is very different. If you go to a village and if you want to install, say, 5 hand pumps in the village, then everybody wants that hand pump should be installed in their own home, not at a place where everybody is benefited. So these are the reasons why Uttar Pradesh is a difficult state for development. So let's close down here. Tomorrow I will talk about that program, self-employment programs, which you must understand because it will help you later on.
Thank you. Thank you.